like eagle that Sunday morning over Salt River. Circled in blue sky, in wind, swept our hearts clean with sacred wings. We see you, see ourselves, and know that we must take the utmost care and kindness in all things. Breathe in, knowing we are made of all of this, and breathe, knowing we are truly blessed because we were born and die soon, within a true circle of motion, like an eagle rounding out the morning inside of us. We pray that it will be done in beauty, in beauty.
This responsive reading is called Valerie's Light and is written by Mimi. Each heartbeat holds a spark.
Spark of life, spark of love, spark of hope.
A single spark lights a flame.
Flame of life, flame of love, flame of strength.
Each flame has a voice.
Voice of life, voice of love, voice of courage.
Each voice has a song.
Song of life, song of love, song of truth.
As we light this chalice, let our memories of Valerie's life and love fill each of us with hope and strength and inspire courage to sing the truths that beat in our own hearts.
We are gathered here this afternoon by love, by respect, by gratitude. Love and respect for Valerie and for her family, and gratitude that we were among the ones who were privileged to know her and have her in our lives. Gratitude that we're able to be here today. You knew and cared about Valerie and her family, or you would not be here this afternoon. And so we invite you to take a deep breath and relax and to feel Valerie's fierce and gentle spirit flowing through you as we tell her story and bind her strength, her tenderness, and her creativity into our hearts, into our memories, and into our lives. We are stronger and more compassionate because she was a part of us.
In the wake of a human being's death, what survives is a set of afterglows, some brighter and some dimmer, in the collective brains of all those who were dearest to them. And when those people in turn pass on, the afterglow becomes very faint. And when that outer layer in turn passes into oblivion, then the afterglow is feebler still. After a while, there is nothing left. This is a slow process of extinction. Our instinct is to believe that the light has once and for all gone out together. I suggest that this is not the case for human souls, because the essence of a human being is distributed over many the brain. It takes a couple of generations for a soul to subside, for the flickering to cease, for all the embers to burn out. Although ashes to ashes, dust to dust, may in the end be true, the transition it describes is not so sharp as we tend to think. It seems to me, therefore, that the purpose of holding a memorial service is to reunite people and to collectively rekindle for one last time the special living flame that represents the essence of that beloved person, the feeling the shared presence of that person. Though the primary brain has been eclipsed, there is, in those who remain and who are gathered to remember and reactivate the spirit of the departed, a collective corona that still glows. This is what the human love means. The word love cannot thus be separated from the word I. The more deeply rooted the symbol for someone inside of you, the greater the love, the brighter the light that remains behind.
And so we come to a time for telling stories. And we tell the stories with a very specific intent this afternoon. We tell stories to kindle the light, to strengthen the afterglow left by Valerie in the nooks and crannies of our shared memories and imaginations. We tell stories to share our grief and gratitude, and to ease our aloneness with the awareness that others also loved her, that others also grieve, and that together, our remembering will help her soul shine for a very, very long time. Our storytelling today is divided into parts. First, Valerie's own story told in her own words. And then, stories about Valerie told by people from various parts of her life. As you listen to the stories, know that you have been invited to help carry the joy, the sorrow, the passion, and the love that those stories contain.
The next four stories are adapted from Valerie's memoir, I Remember Singing. I was born on a First Nations reserve in British Columbia, Canada. There's nothing too remarkable about that, since I have lots of relatives who were also born on the same reserve. Many are still there on the reserve. They may not have much in the way of material goods, but they have many riches. They have each other. I remember singing. I have little more than fleeting memories of my years on the reserve, but I remember singing. I remember my mother, loving, gentle, holding me and singing. I remember putting her necklace in her mouth and waiting until she puffed her cheeks to blast the necklace from her lips. It always startled me, but I laughed and I did it again and again. This is a game I play with my own grandsons. I remember we were berry picking. I loved berries. After a long trip of many days, we arrived at the berry fields. It was marvelous. Everywhere I looked was covered with bushes full of the biggest blueberries I had ever seen. Then I got sick. I just remember coughing up blood. My parents were so scared. I was taken to a noisy place filled with strangers. I was allowed to play in a room with other children. I found a chair and dragged it to the window. The window was open and there were loud, strange sounds outside. I had been sitting there watching the noisy cars and occasional truck rumble by on the street. I leaned out the window to get a better look. My parents were trying to cross the street, but the cars were going too fast. Then I saw them step out and a car came speeding around the corner and hit them. They both went flying and then lay still on the street. The car went speeding off. I was crying for them when I was grabbed from behind and taken back to my crib. I knew that something terrible had happened. I never saw them again.
I discovered later that I had spent almost a year in a hospital with tuberculosis. In order to get me medical treatment, my mom had to sign away her parental rights. I had become a ward of the state. It was common practice to take native children away from their parents in order to assimilate them into dominant society. Well, in my case, my family came looking for me, and everything they tried was blocked. The state continually moved me from home to home, institution to institution. But my persistent family kept finding me. Eventually, I was moved so far away that they couldn't find me again. Many years later, I found my family in Canada. They told me stories of going to Washington State to search for me over and over again, always returning empty-handed. They would find me and try to get me back legally, but the government had many legal stalling techniques to use until I could be moved again. I have learned something even worse. I wasn't the only child taken. I was one of many. After I was released from the hospital, I was put into foster care, where I was moved between different homes several times. In one home, I was beaten so badly, I wound up back in the hospital for a stay. Finally, I was placed with Mama Nicholas. I remember singing. The songs were different and the language was different, but she reminded me of my mother. Every now and then, she would gently catch me, whisper, "I love you," give me a big hug, and then release me. When I finally got used to her, she would lift me to her lap and sing beautiful songs. I warmed up to everyone. It was a marvelous, marvelous house full of love. Mama was the last resort for many broken children, like me. She had two grown daughters, Joanne and Mary Jane. Joanne was married, but came every day to help Mama. She was full of laughter. Mary Jane was in high school and always seemed to have a twinkle in her eye. The three of them filled every room with love and healing and seemed to know exactly how to treat a wounded, half-feral child. They never pushed or forced. They were beacons of love to little souls the world had tried to crush. They were the best medicine a child like me could receive.
Every Sunday, Mama took us kids to Uncle Henry and Aunt Hattie's house for church. Everyone there was so friendly, and the Reverend was the best person. He told us stories about Moses who demanded, "Let my people go," when they were slaves in Egypt and turned water to blood. Moses made it rain fire, frogs, and bugs. He was the most amazing person I had ever heard about. And I liked the way Moses parted the ocean to take his people to freedom. Sometimes, the Reverend also talked about Lincoln, who freed the slaves. Lincoln even fought a huge war to free the slaves. In my mind, both people melded into one person, Moses Lincoln. And the Reverend, lucky enough to know him. I wanted to meet him, but I was told he was dead. Then they told me that Moses Lincoln was actually two men. After I thought about it, I decided that was okay too. I like to pretend that featured Moses Lincoln. He saved people everywhere, not just slaves, and carried children, lost lonely children, back to their parents. He could cure any sickness. Moses Lincoln was my hero. Then I learned about Rosa Parks. She was just not an ordinary hero, but a superhero. She did all sorts of amazing and daring deeds. She could even carry entire buses with just one hand. I tried to emulate her courage. One day I decided that since Rosa Parks refused to sit in the back, that I wasn't going to either. And I'll add, this is about when she was six, just six. I climbed onto the bus and plopped down in the front seat. The bus driver didn't notice until the next bus stop when a white man complained about me. I announced that Rosa Parks was my hero and that I would be just like her and refuse to be pushed to the back of the bus. I refused to move even when the bus driver got angry and yelled and threatened me. Finally, he got up, roughly picked me up by my arms, and threw me out the door. A different man standing outside the door caught me and set me gently on the ground. He told the bus driver that was no way to treat a child and refused to get on the bus. I started my own boycott and refused to ride the bus for over a year. It may not have mattered much since I never paid to ride anyway, but I felt very courageous. I knew I could stand up again for myself and others and survive.
Sometimes the social worker would arrive and take a child away to be inspected by a couple who wanted to adopt a child. I never wanted to leave, so I was always less than cooperative when people came to check me over. But eventually, I had to leave. One day, my social worker showed up and whisked me away in her car. We drove across the floating bridge. She told me how the bridge was made of concrete and floated on the water. I kept close watch since I didn't know how to swim. We drove across an island and into a quiet neighborhood. The houses were built on the hillside and the lawns were all neat. The place was full of flowers. The street had houses on one side and a large vacant field on the other. We stopped at a nice house with a big picture window. The front yard had a nice thick green grass and tons of flowers. A small white woman opened the door. She smiled nervously and let us in. This was going to be my new home. My social worker and my new mother drank tea in these beautiful litter-flowered cups while I roamed around the house and the yard discovering many new things I had never seen in a home before, but no TV. I found a rocking chair and a fish tank and rocked and watched the fish before I finally decided to go inside and see what was going on with my social worker and my new mother. My social worker left, and I was alone with this strange new woman. We sat silently. I gazed out the window, wondering what would happen next. She cleared her throat and finally asked if I was hungry. I nodded, and she got up and ran to the kitchen. She came back with a tray of little triangles of bread on a plate that matched the teacups. There were peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. She got out a magazine and sat and read while I ate. "You don't have a television," I observed, "or books." She looked at me blankly. That night, after I met my new papa, or father, as he preferred to be called, we went out and bought a television. Then we ate out in a restaurant, which was a first for me. This is my new home, and this was my new family. From now on, my life would be completely different. Throughout the rest of my childhood and early college years, I longed for the kind of love my mother and Mama Nicholas provided. Usually, my adoptive parents were somewhat cold and impersonal with me, and usually very demanding. There were many ways in which my life was changed for the better. My new parents' affluence gave me a head start in life that most poor minority children never get. I went on to be the top of my class in private schools, then on to college, marriage to a difficult, abusive man, children, divorce, marriage to a wonderful man, widowhood, marriage to another wonderful man, founding my family of origin in Canada, grandchildren, true happiness. But through everything, good and bad, one thing always stayed with me. Mama Nicholas told me, many years ago, just do your best and follow your heart. And that is what I have always tried to do.
UNMLA, 1981. Valerie, taking laser classes. And my husband, Randy, teaching the courses. That's when I first met Valerie. Then after she completed her degree program, she went, of course, to LANL, and I lost touch with her. Then she started volunteering at the Tourist Information Center. And the brunt of her volunteer time was in 1992, 93, and 94. And then she went UNM, got all of her degrees, smart lady. Then she came back in 2005, 2004. We rekindled our friendship. She told me many stories about her life. One that really stuck with me, and I haven't heard lately, did she actually go through the earthquake, the 9.2 earthquake in Anchorage, Alaska? They moved soon after. We share stories of our kids, her deep pride in her kids. her love for Kirby, and then John in 85. Anyway, when she worked at the Tourist Information Center, sometimes you get people that just aren't with the program. And one person came in, looked at her. Should I tell you that person was from Texas? Then, well, I'm glad you're contributing to the Social Security system. I looked at Valerie, and she's looking right at him. And she says, yes, I am the bona fide FBI resident here, full-blooded Indian. I learned a lot from her and what she survived and how she lived. It's amazing how she contributed and just never gave up. And she just kept making things. She'll never be forgotten. And then I'll always remember John and Valerie and everyone passing up all the lights at Gordon concert, 4th of July, all the kids running around, all the twinkle lights. What a memory. She was my dear friend. She'll always be in my heart. To your precious family, my deepest love.
I first met Valerie at Mackinac College, and it was a brief time in each of our lives, and I won't go into great detail about what Mackinac was, but it was founded by the same people that founded Up With People that Valerie had traveled with, and I had not been in that cast with her. But we were at Mackinac together, and the island is actually a sacred place. It's been a sacred place for maybe thousands of years. And the conference center that was built there was a fulfillment of a prophecy. And when I arrived there in the fall of 68, and that's when Valerie arrived, I believe. She might have been there before I was. And I was in the last class there because Up With People had decided that a college was too expensive to run and they were going to put the money into Up With People, which has certainly shared many wonderful things around the world. But that place was a little utopia, and those of us who were there still talk about it that way because we had an international faculty, an international student body. Our student body president was a black Kenyan in 1968. There was no place like it in America. And I met my first Native friends there as well. And what had impelled me into Up With People was seeing what happened to people in this society that weren't like me. And I wanted to be part of changing that. Valerie and I, we knew each other throughout the school year, but the time I remember the most was after the college closed. I couldn't get a good financial aid package to go anywhere else, and I didn't know what to do, so I stayed there and worked that summer, and so did Valerie. And we were in this house together, and we both had rough starts in life, but we were both people who were we shared our joy with everyone, and I talked to people, you know, about how I was then, and I didn't even remember that, but definitely I remember that Valerie was. And she had such a great sense of humor, and we just would laugh all the time. And I got to tell this story because it's going to keep me from crying some more, but one of our favorite things was to start whistling the opening movement of Beethoven's Fifth and see how far we could get without laughing, busting up laughing. And it just sounds so simple, but we just had a joyous time together. And when we parted from there, we lost touch. And whatever other Facebook does, it brought Valerie and I back together again. And I came here to visit. I was coming here on a trip. I'd gone to the Up With People reunion and been invited to San Ildefonso. And I thought, oh, good, I'll get to see Valerie. But she was on vacation. And so last year, I came, and we got to see each other again. And, you know, when we first connected on Facebook, I wrote that. Do you remember when we would whistle Beethoven's Fifth? She had that same treasured memory. And when I saw her again, I realized we were always with each other. And when I came in today, I said to Mimi, you know, I didn't have a chance to tell her I loved her. But I do. And Mimi said she knew that. And I will carry her with me forever, I know.
When I first signed up for a UNMLA class called Native American Literature in the early 1990s, I had no idea that mine and my family's life was about to be enriched in the most beautiful way. In that class, I met three prolific, inspiring storytellers: Jim Sagal, Mimi, and Valerie Adams. And I also have to add, at that time, I didn't know I was going to meet my spirit sister. I have sisters. Valerie didn't have any. Somehow, we both connected on the same line and realized that we were sisters. In fact, we often joke said we were twins. Except that was very hard on our mother, who had one of us in December and the other one in the following January. There's still people who don't believe me when I say she's my twin. One of those positive outlooks that came from this meeting of souls was when I went back to work in 1997 at Aspen Elementary in Los Alamos. In the fall of 98, the assistant superintendent of schools asked me to start a supplemental reading program called the Monterey Reading Program. It was to instruct students who were reading below grade level but did not qualify for services from other programs. I asked Valerie if she would be interested in volunteering with me, and she quickly agreed and helped me adapt and set up the program within the parameters we were given. The original system was set up for a regular classroom and could be completed in a normal school year of 9 months. However, with our limited time, it took 12 months or more to complete with each student. This meant that each year we would have returning students, new students, and as students exited the program, we would be able to bring in more. Our scheduling was insane. Valerie was able to volunteer an hour and a half, 2 afternoons a week. We had students during the last half hour of school, and then some of the students would stay after school if their parents could adjust their schedules. In a week, she would see 6 to 8 students, and in the 5 years she worked with me, she worked with more than 30 overlapping students. Somehow, she was always able to give the students more than reading instruction in that little limited time she had. She always brought snacks. Her mantra was, a hungry student cannot learn. She also helped provide the prizes our students could purchase with the points they earned. Many times, students were delighted to be given gifts, handmade beaded bracelets, small dream catchers, and stories were among the things she gave. Occasionally, we would discover that a student needed more than reading instruction. Valerie's early childhood experiences had taught her more about what children need to thrive in life than most of us will ever realize. Some of those students might be from families that were struggling with economics or unstable home lives, or even absent parents. She always had an open heart, and her ears were big, finding ways to offer support in an unobtrusive way. She always considered the child's dignity and never caused them embarrassment of any form. For example, sometimes students would find they had enough points to purchase exclusive items like socks, shirts, hats, gloves, food, school supplies, and things that were just not on our usual prize table. During this time, she started doing more work, volunteer work at Aspen, in several classrooms, And she continued that long after the reading program schedules and classroom space changed. In fact, I see people here that had her in their classroom. I think you know what I'm talking about with her generosity. She worked with first grade classes, helped them develop and produce science fair projects, aided the teachers with daily classroom work, and always had time to tell stories. We, the students and staff, were highly blessed by her generosity and loyalty. And I'd like to say to her family, to John and Mimi, Michael, Tara, Sequoia, McCall, Rowan and Devin, I know you're sad. I know your hearts are missing Valerie. And even though we all miss her laughter, her humor, her generosity and stories, she gave you what you need most in times like this. Through her stories and examples, she taught how to be strong. She was the strongest person I ever met. And I am thankful for her sharing and teaching us through her stories how to be strong, tolerant, decent, generous, and humorous human beings.
Is the United Federation of Planets. Ah, and it's backwards. My mom was a huge Star Trek fan. I remember going to a Star Trek convention with my mom when I was a kid. And I wasn't exactly clear that it wasn't real yet, so I sort of expected that maybe I'd get to beam somewhere or that we might get a communicator or something like that. And it was a lot less interesting than I hoped it would be. The Star Trek convention. It was really just a lot of people trying to sell things that we couldn't afford. My dad died when I was 8 years old. And until February 2nd, that was probably the worst day of my life. I don't know how my mom did it. I don't know how she did it. She was 22, 23 years old, something like that. No, she was older than that by then. She was that old when she had me. But she was young, and she was a widow, and she finished school, and she held my sister and me, and she hugged us and gave us love and bought a home and got a job as a laser technician at the Los Alamos National Laboratory. And I guess, like, in summary, what I could say is that my mom was a warrior. She was a little what warrior. We're all little what Native Americans from British Columbia, Canada. And we didn't have warriors who stood there with a weapon and beat people down. In fact, I would have died if I had been a little what, and we got attacked because they would crawl off through tunnels and leave the food for people, because the philosophy was that if they were attacking us for our resources, they needed it more than we did, and the earth was plentiful, so they would escape and leave the food and resources for people and come back later. And I wouldn't have fit into those tunnels. Just look at me. So, my mom was incredible that way. I really appreciate everything I've heard today. I really, really appreciate it. I asked Mikal to go first because I knew that I was going to be nervous. I didn't know that I was going to go off script. And I'm going to try to get back on a little bit here. On January 27th, 1950, probably in Mount Currie, British Columbia, Edith Sam and Joe Joseph gave birth to my mom, Valerie Sam, who you all know as Valerie Adams. Like many Native children of that generation and earlier generations, my mom, as you've heard today, was stolen by my government from her parents so that she could be taught to turn away and be ashamed of her indigenous heritage in favor of the superior white culture which had taken control of this continent several hundred years earlier. This is my mom's memorial. It's not a civil rights speech, but I feel it's important that you clearly understand that part of her history, because that part of her history, that forced and violent dislocation from her indigenous parents, from her community, is core to the person she was, to the person we loved. This part of her story is key to the woman who had bags in her car filled with food and clothing and water. That she handed out to homeless people. Her traumatic experience informed her empathy as she compiled and sent hundreds and hundreds of care packages to her servicemen and women overseas over the course of the last 15 years. The violent beginning to her life is central to the person who volunteered to teach kids at Aspen Elementary School, where I went to school. In northern New Mexico, she volunteered at the Pueblos. She volunteered at other places. She was a fierce advocate for children everywhere, all children. Not Native children, not white children, all children. They talked about the concerts, and my mom, I used to laugh at, you know, a little bit, because she'd hand out those light sticks and stuff, and the kids would run up. The first off, they'd see my mom, right? The kids would see my mom, 20, 30, 100 kids, it seemed like sometimes. They'd see my mom, and they're, "Valerie, Valerie!" And they would all rush her, like she'd be this, it was like the guy with the flute and the mice, except that they were little kids, right? And they were rushing my mom and hugging her, and then she would give them these little light sticks and treats and stuff like that. And she'd stop every one of them as they started to walk away, and she'd say, "What do you say? Thank you." Because manners are important. My mom, I don't know if it was in Up With People or where, but she talked to a group of young women about education. And she inspired one young woman to finish her degree and become a science teacher and teach on the Navajo Reservation in Arizona. And later, my sister and I and my mom traveled there every year while I was in high school to judge their science fair. And we met all these kids, and it was incredible. It was an incredible experience, and they were like, this is Valerie, you know, the woman who inspired that. When my mom landed in that hospital in Seattle, where her mom was blackmailed, literally blackmailed into signing over her parental rights, the prevailing thought in our civilized and culturally superior society was that it was necessary for well-meaning people in this society to kill the savage and save the person. Killing the Indian meant kidnapping generation after generation of young, frightened children and denying them access to loving families, supportive communities, and happy childhoods. It meant the subjugation of several generations to relentless taunting, molestation, rape, and other forms of physical violence, humiliation, belittlement, and shame. Several generations' futures were defined by this agenda. My mom was only one of those generations. You know what's surprising, though, is that in spite of all of that cruelty, my mom's generation were not only resilient, but they were the creators of beauty. They survived being kidnapped and abused and traumatized and spurned and set adrift in a hostile world. They persevered and built futures for themselves and for their offspring. Some went home to the reservations to make a place for themselves. Others went out into white society to build a place for themselves in spite of daily racism and violence. In fact, when I was a child, like a baby, I mean, only a few months old, my mom and my biological father, who the section that me call red said was a violent person, and my mom left him, we had a cross burnt on our lawn because of he was a race traitor. Our next door neighbor was a KKK member, and when I was about 2 or 3 months old, we had a cross burnt on our lawn. And we got out of Dodge, pun intended. Back on the reservations, that generation, they took control of their schools. And they took control of their political institutions, and they forced this country to pass the Indian Welfare Act of 1977. And I'm sorry, I am going to end up going over. And they made sure that the forced removal of Native children couldn't happen again. They took a stand that this terror shall not be visited on another generation. Collectively, that generation for me is nothing less than America's greatest generation. And my mom was part of that. Theirs is a story of defiance against oppression, of resilience in the face of cultural genocide. They were not only survivors, but courageous warriors. And they withstood an onslaught, and in the face of it, they created beauty and a future that I and my sister have inherited, and that we're trying to pass on and preserve for our kids. That was my mom. She was a giant. She was a force of nature. My life is filled with memories of her fighting for me, fighting for my sister, fighting for our family, for her people, for kids. My mom would not be swayed from her conscience, no matter the consequences. She lived by her principles. When I moved to California as a young man, my mom immersed herself in volunteering as a religious education teacher for our UU congregation. And when later she was received some training on her role as a mandated reporter, she subsequently found herself having to report suspected abuse to CYFD. This was not a comfortable thing for her to do. She didn't want to do it, but she was clear about her responsibilities and she followed through with them with resolve and integrity. The result was that there was a huge upset. And in the end, my mom and her family lost their religious community. That was many years before they joined your religious community here in Santa Fe. It had been central to their lives since I was a young child, not a young child, but an early teenager. When later I asked my mom if she would do it again, despite the fallout, the isolation, the heartbreak, she looked at me and she thought. And then I saw her face harden into resolve. And there was a touch of sadness in her voice and she said, "Absolutely." And she pointed at me and she said, "You do the right thing even if it costs you." That clarity is something I've always aspired to, and my mom exemplified it. Throughout my life, my mom has always been there for me and my sister, my father, my friends. She drove me to science fairs, attended swim meets, pridefully attended my graduation, my sister's graduation, my sister's science fairs. She sent me cards every single year on my sobriety birthday, wishing me happy birthday. Our house was the neighborhood house for all the kids. My friends came with us to Santa Fe and to Albuquerque. They called my mom, Mom. She purchased thoughtful gifts on my birthday and at Christmas. I got a note from a friend of mine in high school when he saw on my Facebook page that my mom had passed on. And he told me that when he was 7 or 8 years old in Cub Scouts, he went to a Cub Scout meeting and he was hiding off in the side and he was afraid. And my mom saw him there and she called him over and she talked to him a little bit. And he said that she gave him the courage to go join the Cub Scout troop and have fun. And I got all kinds of notes like that. I got notes from her previous employers. I got notes from her previous college professors. My mom was a beacon of light for all sorts of people. 8 days before she died, we celebrated my mom's 69th birthday at Olive Garden in Santa Fe. She was surrounded by many of her dearest friends. We sang to her. We wished her a happy birthday. Near the end of the meal, she started feeling ill. This illness got worse and turned into severe stomach problems, which landed her in the hospital. Next Saturday, February 2nd, at about 9 in the morning, my mom took her last breath. We all converged on the ICU where she had been being cared for. Most of us had just seen her the day before, when we had laughed and joked with her. I couldn't believe my mom was gone, and I still can't. In her hospital room, we surrounded her body. I tied a pouch of native tobacco to her wrist, and we sang 3 songs together. And we're singing them all here today, too. Today I'm still grieving, but I'm here to tell you that my mom stood for something. She volunteered with kids. She gave generously to anyone who needed it. I received many notes from childhood friends, as I told you. I'm not up here to pretend that my mom had no faults. In fact, I'm kind of embarrassed to admit that I probably was a little too willing to point out the faults that I thought I saw as I was growing up to her. But I'm going to assert that her beauty and her worth outshone her faults exponentially. We lost a giant. My mom and her generation of American Indians were made of strong stuff. She stood for good in this world and she fought for people to be great. She brought courage and hope and love to this world. She was a true warrior and a great role model.
So this is again from my mother's memoir.
Okay.
I first experienced Christmas with Mama Nicholas. One day, Mama sent all of us kids to a party telling us we were going to meet someone special. I was reluctant to leave her side, but she sent me anyway, promising that nothing bad would happen. At Auntie Hattie and Uncle Henry's house, I took refuge in a corner behind a tree hung with lights and ornaments. Auntie Hattie was trying to coax me out when the other children began squealing with excitement. I took a hesitant peek. A large man dressed in all in red and carrying a big bulging bag boomed, "Ho, ho, ho!" I jumped in fright and scampered onto the sofa, squeezing behind Auntie Hattie and burrowing under her sweater. The man in red had a white beard, a giant jolly laugh, and a friendly manner. The other children seemed to love him. He would reach into his big bag and bring out a brightly wrapped package, a crinkly purple ball, and a red and white striped curved stick, one for each child. Eventually, he called my name, then looked at me. I shrank behind Auntie Hattie. The big man brought his chair closer. Uncle Henry said, "Honey child, I'm so sorry we haven't introduced you to our special guest. This is Santa." I peeked at him, but stayed hidden. Santa winked at me and held up a purple crinkly ball. "Do you know what this is?" he asked quietly. I stayed behind Auntie Hattie. "This is an orange. I brought it for you." I might have been scared, but I could definitely see that the ball was not orange. It was purple. I waited before whispering, "It's a purple." Santa grinned. "You're right. The outside is purple." He peeled off the purple paper to reveal an orange ball. "This is an orange, and it's to eat." He held it out to me, and I shook my head. Auntie said, "Come out, honey child. He has a present for you. Where are your manners?" Tears welled in my eyes as I realized I was being scolded. I had done something wrong. Santa smiled and offered it to me again. "It's an orange," he said. I held out my hand and he placed it in my palm. It's an orange and it's to eat, I said quietly. Try it, he coaxed. I lifted it to my lips and stuck out my tongue. No taste, but it was bumpy. I held it to my nose and sniffed. It smelled strange. Then I opened my mouth and took a small bite. It was awful. I quickly rewrapped the orange and put it in my sweater pocket. Do you like oranges? I was at a loss. I whispered again, it's an orange and it's to eat. Mama likes oranges. I will give it to her. A look of puzzlement crossed his face, followed by a slow understanding. Here, let me show you. He took out another orange and a small knife, then cut the orange skin off the ball. He stuck his thumb in the center and broke the orange into sections. It squirted, and he laughed. He handed a piece to me. No, thank you. I'm not hungry. But thank you. Santa paused, handed one piece to Auntie Hattie, one to Uncle Henry, and held up a third one for himself. I watched as all three adults bit into their orange slices and chewed. Again, Santa offered me a piece. Auntie took it and placed it in my hand. Don't put it in your pocket. Try it. I carefully sniffed it, then touched it to my tongue. When I bit into it, I smiled at the sweet taste. Santa handed me the rest of the orange, which I put in my pocket when Auntie wasn't looking. Then Santa handed me a candy cane. Have you ever had one of these? I shook my head no. It's a candy cane. It's sweet. Thank you. I will save this for Mama because she likes an orange that is to eat and she likes a candy cane that is sweet. I placed it in a different pocket. When we got home after the party, the house had changed. There were lights around the windows and over the doors. There were ribbons and bows and strings of shiny beads decorating everything. In the living room was an enormous tree full of colored lights and dangling ornaments with a big star sitting on top. It was even more beautiful than the one at the party. I was in awe. Mama greeted us with big hugs. We showed her our gifts. I placed mine unopened on the shelf by the front door. I took out the orange and smoothed and adjusted the purple wrapping, then handed it to Mama. It's an orange. It's to eat. I also gave her the uneaten segments. I showed her the candy cane before hanging it on a shelf edge. It's a candy cane. It's sweet. I liked the colorful wrapping paper and the ribbons on my gifts, so I left the packages on the shelf by the door. Eventually, when Mama convinced me to open them, I discovered a doll with long, dark hair, like mine, and a beautiful red dress. Mama had also made me a matching red dress to wear. The entire holiday season was magical. We children made paper chains to decorate the house and cut paper snowflakes to hang from the banisters and ceiling. We made each other gifts wrapped with homemade wrapping paper. On Christmas Eve, we hung our socks from a shelf by the tree. In my stocking, Christmas morning was an orange. This time, I knew just what to do with it.
They're purple. Nicole, I need someone strong who can carry this, please. Can you take it?
Through the returning seasons, may I walk. Beautifully will I possess again.
Beautifully birds, beautifully joyful birds. On the trail marked with pollen may I walk, keep speaking. With grasshoppers about my feet may I walk.
With dew about my feet may I walk. With beauty may I walk. With beauty behind me may I walk. With beauty behind me may I walk. With beauty above me, may I walk. With beauty below me, may I walk. With beauty all around me, may I walk. In old age, wandering on a trail of beauty, lively, may I walk. In old age, wandering on a trail of beauty, living again, may I walk. It is finished in beauty. It is finished in beauty.
And these words are written by John. When you miss her, cry.
For she cried.
When you remember her, laugh.
For she laughed.
When you hear her, listen.
For she listened.
When you feel her, dance.
For she danced. Valerie, we loved you when you were with us, and we love you still. We carry you in our hearts. Thank you, friends. We are glad you were here.